Good morning. Please stand and join me for where we sing of golden mornings, number 44. And welcome, Jacob. Good to see you. We sing of golden mornings. We sing of sparkling seas, of prairies, valleys, mountains, of stately forest trees. We sing of flashing sunshine and life bestowing rain, of birds among the branches and springtime come again. We sing the heart courageous, the youthful eager mind. We sing of hopes undaunted, of friendly ways and kind. We sing the roses waiting beneath the deep piled snows. We sing the earth's great splendor, whose beauty round us glows.
Lauren Steele, today's lay leader, and I welcome you to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane with greetings to our online visitors from around the United States and Canada. Whether you're here in our sanctuary today or watching from afar, it's here that we join to create a nourishing religious home with a mission to champion justice, diversity, and environmental stewardship in the wider world. Or as we say more concisely, to create community, find meaning, and work for justice or live justly. Now please take a moment to greet one another. We now turn from our informal greetings to formally begin our services by lighting our chalice, the symbol of Unitarian Universalism, the symbol of our unity and solidarity, of our openness and inclusion, of our community and individuality. May this small flame be our offering of warmth to those who are cold and alone, and a light to those in darkness. May it be a flame that ignites justice in our world, and a beacon of hope to those in need. And may it reflect at least a spark of truth wherever truth has been lost, and cast a healthy shadow of doubt where it has been found. I'm Karen Dorn Steele, your lay leader today, and I'm beginning with an announcement. Next Sunday, on March 3rd, we'll be celebrating in person, yay, our 33-year relationship with our partner church in Felsoraco, Romania. A Hungarian lunch will be served at 12:30 following the second service. Both pork and vegetarian goulash will be offered, as well as bread and desserts for suggested donations of $5 to $10. You'll also have a chance to win souvenirs brought home by people from our church who have visited Festerakos. And raffle tickets are $1 each or six for $5, and will be on sale next week. And now I'm going to introduce our speaker today, Jacob Johns, who is a member of our congregation. Jacob has had a dramatic and painful 6 months. Last September, he was shot by a man wearing a MAGA hat at a prayer gathering in Española, New Mexico, where a crowd was celebrating a city decision to pause the reinstallation of a statue of a controversial Spanish conquistador that had been removed amid the George Floyd protests in June 2020. As the shooter charged an altar erected on the vacant statue's pedestal, Jacob stood in his way. The bullet tore into Jacob's stomach, spleen, liver, and diaphragm, threatening his life. He recently told a Spokesman Review reporter that his heart stopped after he was shot, and in his liminal state, he traveled to the spirit world to beg a council of elders to let him return to life on earth. "I was told that it would be difficult, that I had to work harder," he told reporter James Hanlon. After 5 weeks in the hospital and more recuperation at home in Spokane, he recovered enough to lead an indigenous delegation in January to COP28 in Dubai, the United Nations annual climate conference. Johns, who is Hopi and Akimel Atham, was incarcerated as a young man, but changed his life after prison. He's already a veteran of the climate fight. He protested the Dakota Access Pipeline in 2016 at Standing Rock, where excavations disrupted an ancient burial ground and threatened groundwater. He was pepper sprayed and set upon by guard dogs there. At a climate conference in Egypt in 2022, he interrupted a speech by President Joe Biden with a war cry while raising a banner. He had to sign paperwork saying he wouldn't repeat such a protest. When Jacob was shot, he was deep in planning for the first Indigenous Wisdom Keepers delegation to attend a climate conference. The 15-member group included Native leaders representing the world's bioregions. Their goal was to teach their wisdom and influence the climate conversation. Jacob is now preparing for the next conference at the end of this year in Azerbaijan. He attends because these are the places where fateful climate decisions are made, and he, in the words of Alexander Hamilton, wants a seat at the table. So let's welcome Jacob to our sanctuary.
Please stand and join me for number 1007, "There's a River Flowing in My Soul." Song.
Each time we gather as a congregation, there are always those in our hearts and minds whom we want to wrap in our love and care, including the family of Moritz Kundig, a prominent Spokane architect and UU member since the 1950s, who died on February 10th at age 98. We also mourn the continuing gun violence in our country that has touched Jacob Johns and many others, plus the continued suffering in Ukraine and Gaza. Let us share a moment in silence, embracing others who are here in our hearts, those named aloud, and those remembered in the silence we hold in our community of compassion. It's now time for our offertory. If you're so moved to give to the life of our church, please consider that today. Thank you.
Well, I'm not Pete Seeger, if you might have guessed, but Pete wrote the lyrics, rewrote, to Jacob's Ladder, and I'd like you to sing with me if you know the song. It's not hard. We are climbing Jacob's ladder, brothers, sisters, all. And I'll give you the words. Sisters.
Yeah. Thank you, Pam. Because I was not born here, certainly I didn't know this song. Thank you for introducing that to me. Well, it's time for all ages. I don't see the little ones, but there are different ages certainly here. We may think that we are, well, as humans, smarter, stronger than a small animal like a 15-pound dog. In fact, there is a small animal as small as a dog in this world that is 3 times stronger than a human. Any guesses? Good guess. But here's a tip. This unusual creature lives in Amazon rainforest. Its movements are extremely slow, and it has a locking mechanism that allows the animal to sleep while hanging from a tree branch. What is it? Oh, you're so good. gosh. Sloths are amazing animals. It's hard to imagine. A sloth can starve to death on a full stomach. And you know why? If it gets too cold, then special microbes living in its stomach die, and the animal can no longer digest the food it has eaten. Sloths have a reputation of being lazy creatures and sleep all day. They can remain motionless for 15 or more hours because they need to conserve energy and avoid being detected by predators. I'd like to tell you an episode from a book written by Eric Carle, which is called Slowly, Slowly, Slowly. The story goes like that. 2 monkeys and a jaguar were playing in the forest when they saw a sloth on a branch of a tree. The sloth was slowly opening its mouth while chewing on a leaf. "Why are you so slow?" asked the monkeys. Silence. No answer. "Why are you so boring?" asked the jaguar. Still, not a single word from the sloth. It was finishing eating its leaf. After a while, the sloth turned its head and very slowly crawled down the branch. You know, sloths cannot see in the bright light, but they have a phenomenal sense of smell. Evidently, the sloth needed to smell the company below, near the tree. "Why are you so quiet?" the monkeys went on asking the sloth. "It must be just lazy," assumed the jaguar. The sloth thought and thought and thought. Finally, it replied, "Listen, guys, it's true. I'm slow and quiet and boring, and I'm also sluggish and calm and mellow and relaxed, but I am not lazy." Then the sloth yawned and fell asleep. Sometimes we may assume that someone is too slow, too sloppy, maybe lazy, because they are not acting like we do. But even if we look alike, we are all different. Perhaps we should be more curious and learn from our differences.
As we prepare for meditation, I invite you to relax, breathe deeply, and reflect on words by Rumi that are going to be delivered today by Jacob's friend and fellow activist Bonnie Roberts.
Right here. here.
Thank you. Sorrow prepares us for joy. It violently sweeps away everything out of your house so that new joy can find space to enter. It shakes the yellow leaves from the bough of our heart so that fresh green leaves can grow in their place. It pulls up the rotten roots so that new roots hidden beneath have room to grow. Whatever sorrow shakes from your heart, far better things will take their place.
The song is actually "Behold, the tide is rising," not "Rise on the side of love," but that's all right. Westminster to the back country of Maine, many decades ago. There was wind in the pines, the river ran wild. We gathered round the campfire when I was a child. Swords are splintering. Where can we go?
That was beautiful. Thank you for that. Yeah. I especially like the part about Jacob's ladder. That was a good one. And Bonnie, thank you so much for coming up here. I asked my friend Bonnie to come up first thing this morning to do this reading from Rumi, which is really, really near to our hearts. I think when we start looking at a world that is full of obstacles and walls, that we have to remain faithful that things will work out. That there is a change, and the change brings destruction, but it also brings growth and the rebirth of something new. I wanted to start off this morning to talk a little bit about a local project that we're working on here that involves the church. A couple of years ago, we did a couple of actions and sustained stuff over years, and I know the congregation had been working to change the name from Fort George Wright, from George Wright, to Wistock's Way. And that was succeeded a couple of years ago with the help of a bunch of local groups, and the church was a partner for that. But in the process of doing that, we convinced the city to give us the signs of George Wright, and we had basically formed together a group of artistic people. One is a sculptor, Rick Davis, who unfortunately has COVID today and was unable to come, and then a tribal member from the Spokane tribe, Diane Covington, who is creating the outline of the sculpture itself. So this sculpture is being made, and we are selling these t-shirts to raise funds for it. You can see it says Land Back on the front, which is a big movement for indigenous people here in the U.S., and then we stand in solidarity with our black brothers and sisters who are seeking reparations for slavery in the South and throughout the next. So it says, reparations on the back, land back on the front, where it's a team, it's a movement, and this is a great way for us to move forward together progressively and not repeat the wrongs of our past. And so if you are interested in, it's a $100 donation, $100 or more, and the money is going directly to the project itself. It's going to cost a couple thousand dollars just for the materials and to pay for the artist's time. But we hope to have it finished by the end of the year. So wonderful way for you all to take part in some really cool artistic activism here locally. So that being said, I'm a community-supported organizer. My name is Jacob Johns. I use all human pronouns, and I'm based here in Spokane, Washington. I'm a community-supported organizer, which means that I am like a solo nonprofit group that does intersectional organizing both regionally, locally, and nationally, and internationally over the past couple of years. So I'm like a solo person that does all these things. And some of y'all have recognized me from local stuff, doing a lot of local stuff in the years past, but then more regionally. I have a history organizing for the Democratic Party for single issue ballot initiatives on multiple campaigns throughout Washington State, some of them successful, some of them not. But we want to celebrate the wins. And after Donald Trump became president, I went down to the Backbone Campaign and left the Democratic Party to sign on to, with the Backbone Campaign, to be a community-supported organizer. Just a lone wolf. I was doing a lot of Standing Rock stuff. I had had a week off of working for the Democratic Party, and I took that week and went to North Dakota, which led me into the front lines and getting the dogs loose on me, and they filmed it all and went on Democracy Now, went all over the place. And so I took local fame, so to speak, and raised $5,000 to bring supplies back to Standing Rock the next day. And this started, the next week, this started a whole series of doing supply runs to bring people from the local Spokane area to the front lines. And I've been doing, a wide variety of projects throughout the years. When we focus on trying to change things domestically, even with a Democratic leader in the White House, it's difficult. A lot of people forget that Standing Rock happened when Obama was in the office. And he had every power within his capability to stop that which was going on. The ongoing violence, the perpetuation of this fossil fuel industry that works in partnership with local communities or local governments, I should say. And that itself is scary. That we have to advocate for what's right. We have a moral obligation to stand up for the future of humanity. And after years and all the money and all the effort and everything, the pipeline still went through. There's still oil flowing through the Dakota Access Pipeline today. And it's it's inspired other pipelines, Line 3, Line 5, a bunch of the Mountain Valley Pipeline. These are ongoing things that we have to fight here domestically in order to just advocate for a healthy, just, livable future. And it becomes exhausting, right? We're tired of saying the same thing to the same people. Everybody understands that there needs to be systematic change, but what are we doing about it? And as one person, there's only so much that we can do. And so I started focusing more on national issues versus regional stuff, figuring out ways that we can unite the country from one state to another, one region to another, trying to figure out this, which led me to joining the U.S. Climate Action Network. And as a solo person, I'm in there with the heads of Greenpeace and 350, all these national heads of these large NGOs. The network has allowed me to have a seat at the table to where I was able to actively participate in these policy development and these national campaigns, and they had opened up the door for international activism. For those of you who don't know what the COP is the Conference of the Parties, which is the umbrella, the UNFCCC is the umbrella for the negotiating terms of the climate accords for countries who have signed on to these climate accords in the past. So all the signatories come together and they just negotiate these climate accords. And so the negotiations happen over the year. They switch countries to different places. And the countries were, they're randomly picked. But I was able to get a badge through the U.S. Climate Action Network, which is kind of difficult as just a solo person. I'm not out here with a large budget. I'm always doing grassroots organizing to grab different projects, just like the street sign project here. It's always grassroots stuff. And so to take that grassroots vibe and take it to international situations was wonderful. And the first conference of the parties I attended, I was able to get an official UNFCCC side event, which was about grassroots community solutions and how we can come from the grassroots and apply those moral responsibilities or those moral obligations to policy and disseminate them locally, but from the international space. I gave a 15-minute presentation to the UNFCCC about how I organize. You know, I think that a lot of the stuff that we do is sort of all over the place. There's lots of different theories of change, but as somebody who is of Native American descent, specifically from Hopi, from the Hopi tribe, I'm Hopi and Akimaratam, we have this idea of creating a new world. That, you know, traditionally all of the ceremonies and everything that we do is for the benefit of humanity as a whole, not just for our individual needs or whatever it is that's happening, but for the whole of humanity. And that all of the ceremonies and all of the things that take place are to benefit humanity. And this is the intention. This is what we are put here on this planet for. So taking that understanding and figuring out how we can apply it to contemporary climate policy was very important. You know, and as one person, there's only so much I can do. You know, there's only so much that I can say. I had to grassroots fundraise to get me there all the time. You know, it's expensive traveling around to these different places just to sort of speak to these world leaders and to just have these discussions with the negotiating teams of all these different places. I went to Glasgow, this is my second year doing the United Nations Conference of the Parties, and I was trying to get interviews from people who were there. And it was just doing an explainer video that I did called Code Red for Humanity. The United Nations General Secretary put out a report saying that this is a red code for humanity. This was 3 years ago, right? So a lot of people here domestically don't understand the implications of what happens at the COP, right? Like the U.S., Americans, we're just clueless. We don't see what's happening. We're too entertained with our sports and our media and the other things. But what's happening on these international levels are very, very important, especially when these negotiating teams in our country are supposed to be acting on our behalf and instead are acting as obstructionists to pass progressive climate policy that countries around the world have worked decades to get to. And the U.S. will come in and just say, nah, I'm good. China will follow suit, so will Russia, and the major world economies will follow the suit of the U.S. And so it's our obligation as American citizens to use our free speech to get into these spaces and to remind our decision makers that they are being held accountable by the people of America. And, you know, as somebody who was at the COP when the U.S. pulled out of the climate accords because of, you know, ridiculous things at the White House, it was still important for us to attend to continue to do the work. So as I was interviewing all these people, there's all these profound, amazing people from around the world. I mean, it's United Nations, right? Like there's people from all over the place that are there that you would never really run into in these situations. And I was interviewing people, and I interviewed this one person, and he looked amazing. He was like, it was gorgeous. He was like this flower of a human being who was saying all these very profound things. And I was just like, just eating it up. I wasn't really paying attention to what he was saying. I was just like feeling the vibes from him. He's like, man, this guy is great. And I was gonna go home, and I was gonna edit all the video and put together an explainer of what's actually happening in the negotiations. And his interview was supposed to be the cherry on top of this wonderful story. And when I went back to the footage, I had forgotten to turn on the microphone. And whatever he had said was out in the ether and moved on. So live and learn. You know, I'm not a professional videographer or whatever, but after doing the Conference of the Parties in Glasgow, I started to get woken up at like 3:30 in the morning. And it was really annoying. I mean, it's 3:30 in the morning and I'm just wide awake. And as somebody who spent time in maximum security prison before, I used to get through the 8 years of prison time that I did by meditating. I would meditate every morning. I would wake up. First thing I would do is sit on the floor and meditate for 2 or 3 hours. I mean, you don't really have a whole lot to do, you know, but this was a practice that I took into becoming part of my daily routine. And so when I get waken up at 3 o'clock in the morning, this is a clear sign from the universe that something's being said, right? Like there's a message for you to receive. There is this idea that the early morning has secrets to tell you, but you have to listen. And so here I was in my underwear, 3:30 in the morning, in the living room floor, drinking a cup of coffee and trying to meditate. And I was getting all of these, you know, flashes of things to do and all this other stuff. And one of the practices that we do through meditation in the Hopi tradition is to do a light breathing, where we sit in a meditative state and we breathe light. In the physical world, you're supposed to run towards the sunshine, run towards the sunrise, and then sit as the sun rises in the four steps of sunrise, breathing in the light, charging your body. So you imagine the light coming from the top of your head, filling up your entire body, going to the top of your tips of your toes, and connecting yourself to the light, the divine source, to breathe this space. And so I was sitting there doing this thing, and it was, you know, you sort of imagine yourself as your body dissolves to see yourself as just one sphere of consciousness. And as you see yourself as one sphere of consciousness, you understand that the top of your head is representative of the North Pole and that the base of your spine is representative of the South Pole. And now as you meditate, you visualize the whole of the Earth, the entire planetary consciousness being filled with the white light that is sent from the divine source. And as a sphere, as the planet, I had this visualization that there was a sort of a belt around me, a grid, right? This thing around me. It really didn't make any sense, but then I had this vision that I was supposed to travel the world with different people around the planet to key places to create this grid that we have to do by breathing in light for the entire planet as a collective. 4 hours after I had this really intense vision, I got an email from the man who I forgot to record. He's a human rights lawyer based out of South Africa named Pooven Moodley, who was the executive director of Natural Justice and has done amazing things, is an amazing human being. But he is part of a collective that travels the world to sacred places to say prayers for humanity. And he emailed me and asked me, would you like to join? I told him, yeah. I mean, I told you, I was told that you were going to come, right? Like, it was a little mind-blowing or whatever. And so here I am, all right, I'm agreeing to do this. So I drove down to Mount Shasta, and this group of people from all these world traditions were coming together to these key places based off of the theory of ley lines. So it's this idea that there are key energy grids around the planet that intersect that can amplify your thoughts and your intentions and your prayers. So there was one in Mount Shasta, the Azores, the Great Pyramid of Giza, there's the Stonehenge, there's all these different ones that sort of line up with all these world spaces. And so I traveled with them. We went to Mount Shasta, we went to Azores. When I was in Egypt 2 years ago, I was in. We went to Giza. We were able to get a special visit at 3:30 in the morning to meditate in the Great Pyramid of Giza. And then from there, we went to China, from China to Tibet, from Tibet down to Australia, from Australia to New Zealand. And it was from there, doing all these different places, that they were filming a documentary. The documentary will come out this year. It's called Transformations. It looks really cool. They shot everything in 4K. Really great stuff. But also, I was told that I had to do this stuff, right? And it seems so far-fetched, like, oh, you got to travel around the world, all these different things. But the universe has led me to these places, to doing all this work. And it wasn't just like, you know, something that you do on a whim. This was pretty intense stuff. It was 45 days of nonstop travel. And I just felt compelled to do this. And they would all come together at key places to pray for the benefit of humanity. And we all got together 2 years ago in Egypt. A vast majority of this collective of people are actually participating in the COP. And so it just made sense for us to have our annual meeting night, to have ceremony at sunrise before we get to the COP, so that we can project this global prayer of humanity for us to save each other, for us to step out of this dystopian future that we are all envisioning and walk towards a more beautiful, healthy, livable future. And, you know, as somebody who's very active, but also, like, you know, tries to be as traditional as possible to share with these people all the traditions and the spiritual teachings that come from my ancestors and from my own upbringing, that it made sense that we need to do more. And I think as we understand that we need to do more. We're just going to send some thoughts and prayers. No, we need action. And we need to be able to take this, you know, prayer, this global prayer and all these different traditions and put them together in a concrete way that we can utilize to advance contemporary climate policy that will keep us away from the edge of the cliff that we are all headed towards. And so throughout the year, while I was traveling, I still wasn't able to do it. My team picked up the thing, was able to pull in all these indigenous wisdom keepers from all the world's bioregions. There was indigenous wisdom keepers, there was youth activists, there was just regular activists, and it was just big conglomeration of people that we had worked on for the past year to create this contemporary climate policy that we're going to use to advance at the United Nations. So after I came back from the trip, I was called to the United States, the U.S. Climate Action Network West Coast Regional Meeting, which landed me in New Mexico. And while there, we tried to support local movement spaces. The local indigenous folks asked me to come out and stand with them in a prayer gathering for the statue that they were putting up. And I agreed, you know, I'm always out to come do these things, and especially for this, they said it was mainly women and children. They asked me to come and to spend the night with them just for protection in numbers. So I came and I went. During that time, some agitators showed up who believed that they were the descendants of these conquistadors, and that this was their right in history to put back a statue that they had already taken down. During that time, I was shot. There was a call for all the women were concerned their children who were playing around were in danger, and they got on the microphone and they yelled, "Can you get all the children to come to the center?" And it was from that moment when I was standing that I came out to the outside and stopped somebody who was trying to jump into the center. He pulled out a gun and shot me in the chest. I was in the hospital for 2.5 months. I came to. And, you know, everything hurt, first off. But when I got shot in the chest, it collapsed my lung. It went through my chest, it went through my stomach, went through my pancreas, went through my liver, went through my diaphragm, it went through my spleen. They removed my spleen, and I had surgery for 2 days straight. I woke up, and I had four tubes out of my chest. I was intubated. I mean, it was a long, painful process. And I died. Like, I literally died in the helicopter. Everything froze, everything stopped. And these contracts, is from my understanding, is that we had agreed to come into life to serve different purposes. We are the ones who write out what it is our path is, and it's up to us to obtain those goals. And one of the goals was for me to do this, and my contract was up. And, you know, I'm not here to advocate for anything, but I'm only here to share my own personal experience with being on the other side. I had to go before a council of spirits, and these council of spirits, I had to go over my life and bring out different examples of times that I overcame adversity and pick out different times that I had chose willpower over selfish need, and I'd chosen service to others versus service to myself. And it was a long, drawn-out process. I mean, I can't give you the scope of context of what the linear time space would have been, but it was an infinite moment. An infinite moment where I had to beg this council to let me come back into this space, to let me come back into this body. And in order to do so, I had to sign a new contract, something new. I mean, there are a lot of things that I had agreed to, anything I could do to get back in. They told me it was going to be painful, it wasn't going to be easy, blah, blah, blah. I said, it's fine. I have a little girl who is 11 years old. Well, she's 11 now. She wasn't always a little baby. She wasn't always that. She was a little baby at one point, but I have to come back in to continue to be her father. That's why I'm here. This is a lot of things. I mean, she can't grow up without a dad. And so they allowed me to come back in, and I came to, and I was in the hospital. Painful process. It was really, 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 really rough. But one of the things that I remember that was very important was to continue to do the work of us coming together from around the world to unite around a common voice, and to create these climate policies and this climate documents that bring together all these diverse perspectives in a way that is just and equitable, and more importantly, powerful enough for us to come into these spaces with heads of state and advocate as one unified voice for the future. a logical way for us to move forward and step away from dystopian views that are being fed to us by media and have been for years and by other religions that are full of dogma. The time is now a very, very scary place. You know, we have moved past the tipping points for a lot of things. We are in the state of systems collapsing. Ecosystems are dying and have gone. There's a lot of things that are happening and have already been set in place that we can no longer step back from. But I am here to tell you that from the other side, that things have been decided already. And that coming back into this life and coming back into these spaces to do this work, to continue this work, is what I was instructed to do. And that is a very, very, very powerful thing, I think, for us to remember that despite the destruction of things that we are created to focus on, that these things are failing, that everything is doomed, that the future is unwritten, and that we have the power within ourselves now to mitigate these circumstances that are forced upon us, that are forced upon our children and our grandchildren, that we have the power now to mitigate these things, and that there is a future that is healthy and just and livable. And the more that we can work together, the more that we can unify our voices and stand in solidarity, not just conceptually, but in physical spaces, the more hope that we have for advancing our collective consciousness into this new world that is being birthed as the old world dies. And it's important for us to shift our thoughts, right? Nobody wants to be depressed. As an activist, I get jaded all the time. Like, everything's a lie. Like, nothing matters. You know, it's so easy for us to fall into this, you know, especially, I think, as we get older, is thinking about how this future is no longer ours to do, that it's on the shoulders of our children and our grandchildren. But the truth is that these collapsing ecosystems are on their way right now, that we must take a quantum leap together, not just domestically, but globally, into the new world, that it's important for us to be able to walk hand in hand in a just and equitable way, so that we can advocate for logical steps to pull us out of this chaotic world that is full of emotion right now. I got a grant from the U.S. Climate Action Network before I was shot. This is before I was shot, to continue to do this work. I was able to get a three-year grant for this project that is lasting for 3 years. The first year has passed with me by miracles. We were short. For those of you who don't know, the last COP was in Dubai, which is the most expensive city in the world. I mean, it's literally billionaires and then the working class. I mean, it's like crazy over there what's happening. But we had to raise money to bring 15 people from around the world to come. We had to raise money to bring translators over there. We had to raise money to pay for everyone to live. We had to raise money to feed everyone for the 3 weeks that we had gotten together, which is a big feat. And after being shot, I was really like sort of, you know, I was in the hospital and I'm trying to do Zoom calls, you know, I got tubes hanging out of me and I'm trying to look, you know, do all these things because it was an obligation. This was something that I had agreed to come back into this life, to continue to do the work, to move forward in a concrete, palpable way that is able to be advanced in real time. And so that's a very, very leap of very, very big leap of faith for me personally. This is the second year that we are going into this work. Last year we were $23,000 short of our goal, our projected goal. The National Unitarian Universalist Social Justice group gave us the $23,000 that we needed 1 week before we were about to leave. And for those of you who don't know, that was like such a nervous, stressful thing for us. But I think that walking in faith and understanding that there is a good in the universe, that there is a positive, that the light wants us to shine, the light wants us to broadcast and to illuminate others. And every single action that we take in the present moment and in the future is to guide us towards this divine light that will unite us and save us from our own mistakes that future generations won't have to endure. I wanted to talk a little bit about what the strategy was. Last year, we had fell down since I was leading the delegation. I'd organized everything that I had to recover. And I was, you know, severely damaged. I still have one drain in my liver that is coming out. I have surgery next week to work on it. But I was really not good. I had been out of the hospital for 2 weeks before I left for Dubai, and I did not want to go. I had three drains in me, and I had abscesses on my thing that I had to change three times a day. I mean, I was not in a good state on top of all of the other things that were going on. They shot through my stomach. I cut my stomach in half. It was hard for me to swallow. I mean, it's just all kinds of horrible things that physically happened to me. But the moral obligation for us to continue to do this work is very, very important. You know, there's nothing more important than the future of humanity, and more importantly, the well-being of our planet. And I think as you use that, we understand, you know, this connection, we understand our humanity, and more importantly, can feel the connection between all beliefs and understand that we must utilize all beliefs if we are to project ourselves into this new world and this new destination. In the Hopi way, we talk about the fourth world, the different worlds of incarnation, the different levels of consciousness that we have to tap into, that we have gone from the first world, second world, and third world into this animalistic, smart animal world where we must evolve past this. We must evolve past this animalistic idea that we are stuck in emotions and that we are separate from each other, and evolve into a fourth world, a fourth level of consciousness, which corresponds to our hearts. That we must open our hearts in this fourth world in order to reconnect not only to each other, but to the nature, to the rocks and the minerals, and to the plant life that is all around us. And really open our hearts up to this understanding that all consciousness is sacred. And that we must connect, once again, not only ourselves, but others by speaking truth to power and by advocating for logical steps for us to step away from chaotic energies that will destroy us. And so this year, we are actively bringing together this delegation of amazing, wonderful people to really bog down and create climate policy that can be adopted by world leaders at this United Nations Conference of the Parties. Our aim is to create more bilaterals with the negotiating teams while creating a country map from all the different delegates and being able to advocate and say the same thing so that we are echoing our global solidarity to these world leaders and hopefully having an impact on the hearts and minds of these decision makers. And it's not just the U.S. that acts as obstructionist, and it's not just the U.S. that acts all of these different ways. And yes, we have the freedom here to say so, but other countries do not have that freedom. And that we must stand in solidarity with our brothers and sisters in the Global South, and in the equatorial region, in Africa. We need to stand in solidarity and be the voices for these people, because even though the U.S. may say no to something on these international levels, that has huge ramifications for our brothers and sisters in the Global South. But in us up here in the U.S. won't even feel the slightest breathe of this decision. And that itself is scary. We cannot have a healthy, just, livable future without including all these people, especially who are affected right now from the impending climate collapse that is on its way here. So I would invite you all to follow the work. You can follow a Wisdom Keepers delegation on Instagram and on Facebook. That we've got all of these media that is coming out to amplify the messages, to highlight all of the work that we've done so far in Dubai, but more importantly for us to prep for Azerbaijan and then the next year happening in Brazil, that we are formulating our delegation to be more aggressive in the negotiating rooms where we need to be aggressive. And you know, we have sometimes have to do direct action. Like as they were talking about that I had interrupted Biden's speech in Egypt, which was I was deemed a security threat and had my badge taken along with four other delegates. But we can't just sit around and let people make decisions for us that will not help in the least. And being, as somebody who is very active in a lot of different realms, it's important to remember that we are being anti something and feeding that which we oppose. I think it was Mother Teresa said that I would never go to an anti-war protest, but I definitely would go to a pro-peace protest. And that itself is a paradigm shift that we need. That we can't be anti-establishment, we can't be anti all the rules, we can't just be anarchists, which sometimes we want to be anarchists. We want to feel these things. Everything sucks. But we have to come together and put our minds and hearts together to figure out a world that we can make for our children. And that we must utilize that in a way that is concretely advanceable and, more importantly, adaptable by world leaders. So I just wanted to salute you all for being here this morning. I know it's first thing. We're all here. I was trying to find the balance between too much coffee and not enough. And I just want to just salute you all for being here to listen to these words. And more importantly, invite you all to follow a Wisdom Keepers delegation. You can also check out a wisdomkeepersdelegation.org on the website to follow out all the wonderful things that we're doing. Our policy is out for enjoyment and reading, enjoyment and reading. That's what I meant to say. And more importantly, this is a great way for us locally to really have an impact on these international contributions. And it's important for us to come together and use our minds and stand with each other in solidarity. So I just want to salute you all for being here again this morning and listening to these words. And realize that the future is unwritten. And that we have every opportunity right now to shift these dystopian views of what the future will be like into a more just, sustainable, healthy, livable world. And that we have the power to do it. The future is unwritten.
Thank you, Jacob. Please stand, join me for our last hymn. We're going to sing, it's the Song of the Soul. There's an insert in your order of service. You can follow along, or it's on the screen there. Love of my life, I am crying. I am not dying, I am dancing. Dancing along in the madness, there is no sadness, only a song of the soul, and we'll sing this song. Why don't you sing along? And we will sing for a long, long time. Why don't you sing this song? Why don't you sing along? And we will sing for a long, long time. What do you do for your living? Are you forgiving, giving shelter? Follow your heart, love will find you, truth will unbind you. Sing out a song of the soul, and we'll sing this song. Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. Why don't you sing this song? Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. Come to your life like a warrior. Nothing will bore you. You can be happy. Let in the light, it will heal you, and you can feel you. Sing out a song of the soul, and we'll sing this song. Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. Why don't you sing this song? Why don't you sing along? And we can sing for a long, long time. And we can sing for a long, long time.
As we depart today, I leave you with the words of another climate activist, Bill McKibben, in his book, Earth. We must step up the fight to keep climate change from getting even more powerfully out of control and to try to protect those people most at risk, who are almost always those who have done the least to cause the problem. Amen. Blessed be. Salam alaikum and shalom.
Shalom, Havarim, shalom, Havarim, shalom, 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 Havarim, shalom, Havarim, shalom, shalom.
What a great service.
Yeah, it was good. He did good.